Thank you very much, the organizer, for this kind invitation and for allowing me to present some of the data produced by the project Plant Libra. Plant Libra means plant food supplements, level of intake, benefit and risk assessment. And as said before, this project started in June 2010 and finished in May 2014. The project was based on a big consortium, including 25 partners. I have no time to discuss in detail the partners, but 21 of these partners were located in the European continent, and the other one in three other continents. So it was a very huge project. Really, the main objective of this project was to focalize the attention on the different aspects related to plant food supplement, PFS. And since I have only 30 minutes to present the results, I will focus the attention only on some of the results, and in particular to those areas where publication has been presented in the literature. So we have some paper published from the project, and some other paper are accepted for publication. So you will find this data published and at disposal in the literature. The first data I present here are related to the survey on consumers. This was performed in six countries in Europe, and particularly Finland, Germany, Italy, Romania, Spain, and UK, just to have a picture of the Europe, from the north to the south, to the east to the west. And the idea was to collect new data on the most frequently used PFS, and including the botanical use in this PFS, data on the reason of use and the expected benefit from the consumer. We try to obtain some data on doses, number of units, and sometimes the quantity of the active molecules. And this was used in the second period for risk assessment. We collect data on adverse effect and consumer perception. This is the situation of the countries included in the study. As I said before, there were six countries, and for each country, four cities were selected according to the geographical distribution. And all cities were involved in collecting a certain number of consumers. The original idea was to collect a number sufficiently suitable from the statistical point of view. So we decided to collect at least 400 consumers in each country. To reach this number, it was necessary to perform a certain number of telephone calls. And as you can see, the number is different in different countries. And the number of the first contact was more or less 2,000 people to reach the 400 selected consumers. These are the numbers selected in each country. We decided to have more or less 50% of male and 50% of female. And we decided also to include 2/3 of consumers aged between 18 and 60, and the other above 60, just to have an idea of different consumption according to the age. So, using this data, we are able to calculate approximately the number of consumers in these six countries in Europe. Of course, I have no time to describe in detail how we define a consumer, but consumer is a person who decides to use PFS during the year for at least several weeks, not once in the life. So they were selected according to the use. If we use this ratio between the number of consumers selected on the total screened people, we can obtain a number that is indicated in the orange bars. And so you can see we have a certain difference between countries, but more or less the percentage is 20%. This number is a little bit different if we correct this number for the size, the overall population size. But anyway, the number of consumers is more or less 20%. We have some exception, for example, Finland, but I have to underline that in Finland, botanical are used often in medicine, traditional medicine. And these were excluded because the objective of the project was only food supplements. So when people indicated that they use as traditional medicine were excluded. So this number is probably low according to the real use and the actual use in the population. In the group of consumers, we just started to understand how often these people use PFS, and the number of people using PFS all year round was quite high in some countries, for example, in Finland, United Kingdom, more or less 50% of the group selected consume PFS all the year. In other countries, was low frequent, as for example in Italy, where only 12% use these products in during all the period. During the collection of data, we collect 1,288 per different products. Of course, there are a lot of products in the market. Some of them are present in different countries. Some others are just present in one of them. The total of these products were more than 1,000. These products contain 491 different botanicals. And also in this case, you can see some differences in the countries, but it's not so big. Only United Kingdom is a little bit different. The number is lower. And these products were produced by 449 companies. So as you can imagine, but I know you know this very well, the number of products on the market is very big and the number of producers is very high. We try also to understand if the consumer prefer to use a mono botanical or a product containing different plants. As you can see, most of them prefer the products containing only one plant, but there are different percentages in other situations. For example, for two botanicals are 16% and so on. It's not possible to see in the picture, but there is also a very little percentage of products containing more than five different plants. According to the use of different products, as you can see, most consumers prefer the product containing one single botanical, but also multi-botanical are consumed in different countries. You can see some differences. I have no time to describe in detail these differences, but in some way, you can see immediately that there are differences. For example, for one single botanical, there is a very big percentage in UK and lower in Finland. And there is a very high percentage compared to the other countries in Finland considering products containing two or more products. So there is some differences in the countries, and I will show that there are also differences in the type of botanical and the reason of use. starting from the reason of use. Also in this case, we have some countries that have a similar picture and others that are totally different. Considering the total of our survey, the most usual reason of use is to improve the defense system, so the immunity. And the second one are products improving energy in sport, or also generally speaking, just for tonics. But if you look at the different countries, you can see that there are differences. Finland is quite similar to the total of the survey. Germany, as a first reason of use, the function of gastrointestinal tract, and the second, the immunity. And Italy, too, have the same situation. The first is the gastrointestinal tract, the second, energetic products. In Romania, is exactly as the total of the project. Spain is a little bit different. The first reason of use is the body weight control, and the second one is still the gastrointestinal function. United Kingdom is quite different. They are more interested in product reducing the problem in menopause and to product increasing mood. So quite different from the other countries. We collect also data about the sources of recommendation for PFS consume. And also in this case, there are some little difference. Considering the total of the project, the first column, you see that the most usual is to ask friends or relative about suggestion in this field. This is true in 4 out of 6 countries, but there are some differences in Finland, where more or less 50% is the friends of relatives, the source of information, and the other 50% more or less is due to nobody. I just look at information by myself. The other exception is Italy, where the most important is the herbal shop assistant. This is not stranger to me, because in Italy we have a specific degree in this activity, in this profession, so probably people trust in this professional person, figure. So it's not strange. The second position also in Italy is friends, relatives. Regarding the price of purchase, also in this case, most countries indicated that the most important place for purchase is herbal shop. Romania is a little bit different from the other country, and the most important shop is pharmacy. It's quite curious that the percentage of supermarket is very low in all countries, and internet is indicated as a very unusual source of to have this product. Probably this is not exactly the true situation, but this is the data obtained by the survey. About botanical use, this is the situation considering the whole survey. These are the 10 most used plants. I remember you that the total number is very high, 400 botanicals, but these are the most used. Ginkgo biloba, Enotera bienis, Cinara scolimus, Panax ginseng, Aloe vera, Phoeniculum vulgare, Valeriano officinalis, Melissa officinalis, Echinacea purpurea e Glycinem max. So these are the most used. The first two are the most cited, and so on. But if you want to look a little bit at the situation in different countries, you can see that we can see that there are real differences in this. And I just show you the three most cited plants, because if not, it's too big the number of columns. And so you can see that there are differences in countries. And this is associated to the different use, reason of use of PFS. So, for example, in Finland, the most used is Glycinemax. In Germany is Ginkgo biloba. In Italy is aloe vera. This was a real surprise because this is a new knowledge, because really we understand that aloe vera is included in a very high number of PFS. This was unknown to researcher, not to the company, of course. In Romania, Ginkgo biloba is the most used, 26% was cited, and Cynara scolymus in Spain, and Enotera bienis in United Kingdom. So you can see that there is a certain difference in the market of the six countries. This is quite curious. We ask the people, do you think the product helps you? And the result is quite curious, because yes, most of them say sometimes, always, but there was a certain number of people replying not at all, rarely, or not sure. And these are people using continuously, or at least for a long period, products. So quite strange, but this is the situation. So as you can see, for example, there is more or less 10% of people in Italy using these products saying, yes, I have benefit rarely. I don't know. We ask also for adverse effect, and the number of adverse effect indicator was not very high, but you can see that in each country there is more or less 5% of people indicating some adverse effect. I will talk in more detail after. So, lesson learned one, the number of chronic consumer of PFS is quite high, with some differences between countries, as we have seen. Differences are observed in the most used botanicals and, as a consequence, in the reason of use. Most consumers believe that PFS could help always or something, but a certain percentage uses PFS without having confidence in a positive effect. A relative low percentage of consumers reported adverse effect, and no severe reaction was described. Most of them were gastrointestinal disease or something like that. We just discuss now the most important result of this survey. If you want, you can look in detail the result of this survey. The paper is free, you can download freely by internet, and it has been published in PLOS One. Now we are working publishing data at national level and for specific area, for example, for adverse effect and reason of use and so on. But for the moment, there is this publication collecting the most important data from the whole survey. Another point discussed in our project was the problem of benefit and claims. All of you know that there are a lot of discussion about the problem of PFS and the production of scientific data for a suitable health claim. Plant Libra discussed about the possibility to develop new tools and or models to validate claims starting from the tradition of use where possible. Starting from methods must be of the highest quality achievable, and it's important to combine in vitro and in vivo studies. Generally speaking, we support the use of in vitro study at the beginning to reduce the number of not clinical or study on humans, because you know the study in humans is very expensive, and so it's better to have some models before that could reduce the expenses for reach the suitable data. How we can do this is not easy, as you know. We suggest that it's important to have in vitro tests having a correlation with in vivo situation, and that the human test must be developed to obtain significant results in short time with limited cost. If not, it's quite impossible to believe that health claim will be supported by scientific data. Too high cost, no data. This is the result. During the last meeting of Plant Libre in Vienna, this was done in May 2014, there was a workshop on this specific topic, and the most important experts in this area were invited to present their opinion. I have no time to summarize this workshop, very interesting workshop, where different opinions and ideas were presented. And I'm happy to say that there was a certain agreement between these experts, and now we are ready to prepare and publish papers. So the lesson learned too. There are critical points in defining the suitable experimental approaches to support health claim. A big work is necessary, both in collecting data disposal, and in this case Plant Libre collected some of them, and in preparing scientific guidelines. Conclusion coming from the workshop organized in Vienna will be reported in two papers now in preparation. All expertise are necessary to reach the goal in short times. This means companies and research and so on. All should contribute to improve the situation. About adverse effect, we are talking about risk and benefit, so we also consider the adverse effects. We started collecting data from the literature, from the scientific literature, using database, and I summarize quickly the result of this collection because it's very big. At the beginning, we decided how many plants, including this search, because you can imagine 400 is too much. So we decided to include 56 botanicals, the most used, and we collect all the possible data regarding adverse effect. You can see here the result of plants having the highest number of citation. They are 14, and you can see the bar with the number. Of course, this is not the total number of papers. The total number were very, very high. But we decided to look at each paper and to classify according to the WHO causality rules. So we decided to include in the final evaluation only paper where the causality was described enough, was convincing. In this way, the number was reduced a lot. And the most cited Glycinemax, soybean, is not a surprise. We have a lot of allergy to soybean, so this is an adverse effect very known. And you know, Glycinemax contains some estrogenic compounds, and this is the second most cited adverse effect for Glycinemax. Licorice is the second one, and also in this case is not a surprise because licorice is known having hypertensive activity, and the activities in this sense. And then we have a certain number of other plants with adverse effect quite well known, as Camellia sinensis for hepatotoxicity, and so on. As you can see, the number, apart from the first four plants, is not so high, considering that we look at the literature from the origin to to now, so very, very long period. We have also to say that there are two different kinds of adverse effects. Some of them were associated specifically to the plant, as I said before, allergy or estrogenic substances and other active molecules, but some of adverse effects, and sometimes were numerous, as in the case of Citrus aurantium, the adverse effect was due to an interaction between the plant and the conventional drug. So the two adverse effects were classified according to the situation. Citrus aurantium improved the adverse effect of other stimulating molecules. Also, these data are now organized in a publication and has been accepted for publication just some weeks ago. And it will be published in the British Journal of Clinical Pharmacology. In this paper, there is a short references, a short number of references. This is 150 because this is the limit of the paper, but is at disposal the total list of references classified according the causality level. So you can look, I hope in the next week, at the paper and the total collection of papers. We also collect data on adverse effect, organizing a network with Poison Center, European Poison Center. And this was organized by our Swiss partner. And all European Poison Center were contacted to have a reply about the adverse effect to PFS. 64 poison centers were contacted, 34 didn't reply, 30 of them replied, and 10 of them sent cases. The other one say, no, we had no cases of adverse effect to plant food supplements. I finish. 2 minutes. Okay, this is the result of I look at 30 because I saw 30 minutes, this is the problem. So, this is the situation. And you can see that there was 33 cases for Valeriano officinalis and so on. I said before what happened, so I can go very quickly at the end. All data were included in the database of Plant Libra. This is the general structure, and we can see that every kind of information was included in this database. And all data collected were used to develop a platform for risk and benefit website. About using OPASnet, we try to develop a model for evaluating benefit and risk in the field. It was validated with 5 different plants, and the lesson learned that is the acceptability of a risk-benefit assessment in the field of PFS is still controversial, you know very well. Plant Libra developed a new platform, but it must be validated for a higher number of botanicals, and the rules for including data from the literature are necessary because the data in the literature are good and bad. Rules on the use of platform must be decided not to facilitate misuse, because this is a risk. Since I have no time to give you any other information, you can see at our website, it's still working, so you can find different documents. There is the download area. You can see publication. Of course, you can find that the whole publication only in the case of open access, in other cases there is the reference. So I thank you for the kind attention. I sorry for the delay. And this is the group at the beginning of our project. And as you can see, it's very big. And I thank you for attention.